Welcome back to the Smite Console League EU edition. I'm John Finch. I do have Taco here with me. And after Rival take that first set 2-0, CAZ eSports and Eanix got their work cut out for them.
It was a little bit of a battle, I would say, for Rival initially, but in the second game they did manage to clean it up. And now, really big chance to see whether or not the other remaining European teams are going to be able to have the same sort of competition going on.
That's right. Right now, Eanix is sitting at 3 points. They did get the 2-0 last week, actually, against Rival, so they were in a really good spot. Now, though, with Rival getting all 3 points there from taking the 2-0 set, it kind of puts the pressure on them. If Rival want to stay up at the, or rather, if Eanix want to stay up at the top, they got to show up here in this match.
And this is a very, very crucial set indeed. Like you just mentioned, it's important to try and separate yourself from the rest of the pack. So getting another 3-point victory here would make all the difference between determining who's first and second seed for EU.
And with CAZ splitting last week, only having 1 point now since they went 1-1, I believe, with ERA, they're going to need every point they can get here too, just to try and keep up. So at least a split is what CAZ is going to be looking for. If not, getting that 2-0.
And it's what better way to show it off than, you know, second week in. So that's another really important thing. This is a little bit shorter for EU since there are four teams available. So this really will be the telling tale here.
That's right. This will be the last EU set for this week, and they only have one more week. So we got those picks and bans ready for you here with CAZ and Eanix, ready to go at it. And right away, Odin ban. No big surprise there.
And anything else to be expected other than the Scotty ban following up shortly after. Yep. I wouldn't be too surprised here to see. Actually, there it is already. Terra going to be taken away as well.
Well, CAZ just don't want to have to deal with Odin and Terra. Too much lockdown, too much control. We also see RDO getting banned out. So far, everything's looking kind of standard for him with those bans so far. And then Erlang Shen getting picked up.
A lot of pressure potentially here from the Erlang, whether you want to flex pick it into the solo lane or even potentially in the jungle. There has been a lot of bruiser gameplay, throwing those warriors into the jungle, having that mobility with the Erlang. And then on top of that, just a lot of burst potential from his Shred.
And Eanix looking tanky right out of the gate with the Sun Wukong and the Geb. Also be able to provide some survivability to any of their other teammates with that Geb shield. And then CAZ taking Kukulin and Sobek.
I actually really like the Sobek here because of the aggressive gameplay that can come out, especially if that Sobek is going to be in the support role, which I would probably favor here considering that it is a Geb, and I can't anticipate a Geb going anywhere else other than support. This isn't Deathwalker, so shouldn't be a solo laner here.
And we see Awilix picked up here by Eanix, not just to combo with the Geb, but I think it's also a good idea to not let Awilix and Sobek be on the same team. Just a little bit too much synergy between those two guys.
Awilix has a lot of flavor when it comes to the console side of things.
Yeah.
A lot of players tend to really love that feather step, just so much AoE burst damage that can come out really early on. You pair that alongside of a Geb, I mean, you've got really easy setup for your ultimate. All around, a pretty standard combination of gods.
I like what we're seeing so far. They do ban out Artemis and Hell, so those won't be available for CAZ, but they're able to find their healing elsewhere. They pick up Ra, more than likely going to be their mid laner, and have Medusa locking that out for them. So still a good bit of control from that comp.
CAZ has a lot of team fighting mentality set behind their draft. You can really tell that that's kind of just being locked away with the Ra, kind of banking off of that sustain. And having such a heavy front line will make things a little bit more difficult to try and make that Awilix Geb Scylla combination come to fruition.
Yeah, there is plenty of setup for this Scylla. I'm glad that you were talking about her. In particular, Awilix can pull him back in and even get that little sort of mini root or stun at the end of that feather step too. So just a little bit of lockdown to help make life easier for Scylla in particular. I believe that's going to be 50-meter fly. We see Eanix pick up that Scylla, so likely 50-meter fly will carry that one on for him. But let's go ahead and take a look and see where Erlang ended up, as well as Mr. Turtle's going to be the one that takes Kukulin, and then it's going to be, they're going to take Mr. Turtle's going to be the one taking Kukulin.
Okay, no surprises there. Maloaise taking that Erlang into the jungle is a pretty anticipated play, considering that Erlang has seen a lot of positivity being in that jungle section. He's just has so much space and control that you can get away with, and it's really easy to just work around him.
Yeah, Erlang Shen, he does so many things, like as you were saying, so much setup that he's able to provide for the rest of his team. You can see that in particular, that Raw Snipe gonna need a little bit of help just to make it a little bit more reliable. It's kind of the only reliable damage that Raw can bring in a fight. I mean, his one can do some good damage if you can hit it, but it's not the easiest one. It's kind of a slow-moving beam, so when Maloaise comes through, sets up his team, they're gonna be able to take him down with that Raw.
Erlang and Ra, though, is probably one of the more classic combinations as well that we've really been seeing a lot of play out of ever since, I would say, Eager actually brought it out with Aurora and the best, and now it just seems to be a pretty staple environment for teams to try and work around.
And we're seeing some pressure here from Auzrik in the mid lane, actually getting forced back by what Elexum and Atonement are able to do in the mid lane. The clear between Medusa and Ra is pretty nuts, and they're already coming over to put pressure, not just on the speed buff, but even the blue buff for Eanix are getting pressured out, so they're going to have to try and rotate over and keep those alive.
If I'm Eanix, though, I'm basically anticipating this to happen. I mean, just looking at the draft from Kaz, that is all early game pressure for the most part, except for maybe, well, no, even the Sobek has some kind of early pressure possibilities with that pluck. So it's going to really be about Eanix trying to control their own positioning, not getting caught out.
And Bede's already having to come out for Elexum on that Raw just from the control that Auzrik's able to provide with that Awilix in the mid lane. So another 145 seconds or so on that cooldown for him. And that's a setup if Awilix can come in and get a knockup at that Moonlit Charge where she won't have to worry about Raw trying to avoid it.
I like the play, though, from Eanix, recognizing that they lost their buffs on the solo lane side of the map, immediately opted to invade those of Kaz, stripping away that purple buff, most likely having contested for the red as well, and securing their own dual lane buffs just means that it's actually going to be more XP for Vaporish Coast in the long run.
And this is where we were able to see Eanix sort of lose the least on the map so far. I think you're right. Over here on this dual lane side, they did a good job staying even. It's over here where Atonement was able to help provide some pressure with Elexum, and Maloaise and Mr. Turtle got a bit of an early advantage that have Eanix kind of in a tough spot in that solo side jungle. So when that next rotation of buffs come around, they're going to be trying to look to not lose any more farm on that end, but it's Kaz on the left side. They're doing okay.
And Atonement, he does have that speed buff around him. He already doesn't have a side strafing penalty for his auto attacks thanks to that Medusa being Medusa, and that's always a plus. But one thing you have to keep in mind is that they still need to be incredibly careful if you're Eanix, because there is so much burst that could come out of the Medusa and the Sobek, and since Atonement does have that speed buff, it'll allow him to catch up a little bit sooner.
If I was Eanix, I'd be worried about CAZ eSports, not just their team fighting potential, but even their objective potential with all that burst damage that they're able to force out. If they can pull you into those tighter jungle corridors, force you to fight over there, like you said, in particular, Atonement on that Medusa can, with that narrow area, can really shut things down and have good follow-up from the Raw as well. So it could be kind of a scary situation early.
Yeah, I just had to take a little bit of a brief pause. Players trying to figure out where exactly they wanted to go on the map.
That's right.
All things considered. I mean, it happens from time to time.
Yeah, just a real brief pause. We got the game ready for y'all right back, so we're going to keep it going. No problem. Just like we saw before, Turtle and Maloaise having a good time over here in that solo lane, trying to make things hard on Auzrik and Predators.
And Elexum actually running quite low on his mana here, having a little bit of a difficult time, I'd say, farming out super efficiently. He should be relatively safe, though. It is a Raw. Raw has the ability to clear the wave at least, but having a back so early does mean that he's actually going to opt for the T2 boots instead of keeping on with that Book of Thoth Rush.
And that's a pretty big deal. Likely, we'll still be able to see 50-meter Fly go back and start getting that Book of Thoth finished off, get that power spike, and start stacking. So Ra's going to have to try and, or not Ra, rather, but Elexum had to capitalize on that movement speed that he'll get from those boots, and he'll get some from his passive as well to try and make up for the fact that he might not have as much power as 50-meter Fly early on.
Well, we've seen it a lot, actually, with mid laners opting for the Swift Wing even to try and get back into the lane. T2 boots is 900 gold, but that's going to be an item that also provides a little bit of power, so that's kind of something to keep in mind.
And it's something you want to keep around with your build. The taunt does come out from Maloaise, but not able to catch Auzrik. The damage from Turtle was almost enough. Mr. Turtle trying to make that Awilix pay, but just able to skate by, and he's hanging out that tower line saying, you better back.
I love the discipline there by Kaz, though, recognizing that, sure, they could have dove the tower, maybe looked for the kills, but why make the risky play when we can go for the safe one, invade the speed and blue buffs easily, and with Auzrik and Predators being forced out, there's absolutely nobody to try and contest that.
Elexum able to come over easily and help secure the blue buff as well, so now no buffs on this solo lane side available for Eanix. Predators and Auzrik once again have to go without those buffs. And that's sort of what we were talking about. That could be the advantage for Elexum there in the middle lane, and an easier time rotating over and being a part of that.
Well, the other reason why this hurts so much for Eanix as well is because Predators actually opted for that Hand of the Gods, and not getting the benefits out of even being able to secure his own buffs with that relic pretty much makes it useless.
That's right. He did go with the more defensive options. Both of our solo laners did. Mr. Turtle has beads as well to try and handle the ample crowd control that's going to be coming out from the other side there on Eanix. So I don't blame him. I mean, Awilix, Geb, even Scylla with the root could be nasty sometimes. So you want to make sure you're able to avoid those. But Eanix coming over and trying to get these oracles, and actually both of them getting taken by Elexum. So a good win for them there.
And that's always the positive vibe for the team. Whenever you're able to secure those and have a little bit of contest, that's always where you want to be. And Mr. Turtle and Maloaise probably just going to keep hanging out with each other. Maloaise probably having the most kill potential right now in that solo inside, kind of forcing Auzrik to hang around that solo.
And we already see just how far ahead Maloaise was able to get up over Auzrik. Look at Auzrik down at the bottom of that XP for Minute Charter. Moving up a little bit now, just after getting a little bit more farm. Maloaise and that pressure they've been able to put on that solo side has started to give him a bit of an early lead. We even see it coming out in those levels there. They're about a half a level or so ahead, maybe closer to about a full level, as we just saw the two of them turn over to level 8. So that's something they could start moving towards into not just jungle bust, but forcing team fights.
And I'm a little bit surprised, though, that CAZ hasn't tried to force their draft a little bit more upon Eanix. And I mean that in... Oh, actually, take that moment for a second there, because that was Cataclysm coming out from Osa, but it's actually Switch who's going to be cleaned up by Auzrik. DineOhSaw, that was a great Cataclysm.
Yeah, that Cataclysm was what set everything up for him. The follow-up from 50-meter fly was great, so they could clean up that kill onto Switch, no problem. Elexum just trying to do what he can to help keep his support alive, but wasn't able to do it in the end. And that's the first blood going to Eanix. And actually a little bit more of a slapbox over here. Ultimate coming out from Predators, but he's not going to look to chase down Mr. Turtle. Knows that Kakalin's still a little too tanky. Just going to enjoy all that healing. Look at him almost back up to full HP.
Full HP nearly, but that mana bar is not anywhere near the same amount. Maloaise also making the rotation just to follow up and make sure that Auzrik and Predators aren't trying to get anything up over the Kakalin.
Scylla was able to go ahead and get that that Book of Toth finished out, rather 50-meter fly. So that's what we were talking about. That's a bit of a power spike that she was able to get into early. She won't have any of the mobility, won't have like sustain or anything that Ross sort of has inherent in his kit. So he's a little bit safer going with the Book of Toth without maybe like the Shroud or some of those other sustain options, because he's just got some healing in his kit that Scylla doesn't have. So Scylla's got to make full use of the power like we saw in the mid lane fight when 50-meter was able to help clean up that kill on the Switch.
One more time though, and actually Atonement with his own successful invade on the red buff kind of caught Eanix sleeping a little bit there. Three members actually just went to go check and see if they could drop that buff, but it had already been stripped away.
One more win for Atonement there. Be able to steal that buff and move back in. Still, though, I want to ask you, Taco, do you think CAZ are taking it a little too slow here through this early game?
Definitely. Considering that their draft is so early game oriented, I am very surprised that they haven't tried to do a little bit more than just the invade. And that's kind of what I was trying to bring up before Eanix was actually the one making the play in the mid lane. DineOhSaw turning up the aggression. And as Geb, that's not really something you'd expect, especially sitting there around level 8. It can be kind of risky trying to just drop your Cataclysm. And that was Atonement's ultimate, Petrify, coming out trying to steal those oracles, and it was completely unsuccessful.
Yeah, that's a little too bad. Atonement trying to help take away those oracles, but it wasn't timed quite correctly. They do end up securing that to Eanix. But I got to agree with you here. Scylla feels very much like a late-game mage. Awilix is early game, yes, but her impact still is very strong with her displacement late. Rom in particular with his steroid, very strong in the late game. Yes, Medusa's steroid's also very powerful, but it's only 3 shots that it works on. Rom's is like several seconds long, giving him that increased attack speed. So it's something you definitely don't want to be dealing with from Vapor's Coast.
The thing is that even though CAZ has had numerous successful buff invades against Eanix, it's actually Eanix who's only trailing by a few hundred gold. That is pretty much nothing when it comes to 9 minutes and climbing in a game. And you want to have established at least a 2-3K lead, maybe even, with this kind of composition, because you can just easily start to snowball ahead and really just keep the pressure going. But It just doesn't seem as though Kaz is really... They're just content to kind of keep farming.
And Eanix, I think the reason why it's been a little difficult for Kaz to try and force them out of position or start anything up, Eanix have strong ward control over the map. They got several wards over here on the dual lane side of the map. They have, it looks like, only one for each team, or two, rather. Now we see as Predators kind of moves out of the way a little bit. There are two on this solo lane side, so they got plenty of vision over the map. They're able to move safely throughout it, and Kaz are having a hard time forcing anything.
And it'll be interesting to see how Kaz chooses to respond. As the game continues to progress, I'm certain that Eanix, if anything, will start looking for those more attack-oriented paths. And that's kind of just what you need to see happen. As soon as Scylla and Awilix can get their synergy and their combos online with those itemizations building up, it's going to be pretty difficult trying to avoid some of that damage.
Overall, though, it looks like Scylla, or rather 50-meter flying Elexum, end up pretty evenly in their builds. They both got Book of Toth and the Pin Boots finished out now. A little bit ahead in the stacks is 50-meter fly, as it looks like, once again, the evade's coming out on the speed buff from CAZ eSports. The pluck does land onto Auzrik. It's pulled back into the knockup from Mr. Turtle. That's going to put out tons of damage. Cataclysm hits two members, though, and that's going to let Auzrik move a little bit further away from the damage coming from the rest of the team. But Elexum's there to clean it up, no problem. Predators up on the cloud looking to crash down, but Mr. Turtle just gonna back away.
Predators just wants to get into safety or maybe even look to contest his blue buff. He does still have his hog available, but without his ultimate, that's gonna make it incredibly risky trying to force his way into that pit. And in fact, Switch, with the very solid zoning, keeping Predators forced out, not even able to check on the health to look for the steal with the cudgel.
And that makes it even more impressive what Kaz has been able to do with these buffs. We said before they weren't taking maybe like the fights, but they were doing the buff invades. Predators has the hand of the gods. Why isn't he closer in there trying to contest these buffs and get the last hit on them?
Well, Predators was actually zoning out Maloaise and Mr. Turtle at his own blue buff. The speed buff had just spawned. He was trying to ensure that Auzrik could pick that one up safely because Eanix did rotate to that speed at last, feeling a little bit more confident in having that defense option available. And unfortunately, it was still just too much early damage from Kaz, and Kaz just finally used that to their advantage.
Able to clean up Auzrik in that last engagement, falling. He's still actually hanging pretty close with his jungle lane opponent, Maloaise, there, at least in terms of gold, but the XP is where Maloaise is sort of enjoying a bit of a lead over him. So Auzrik, the one who kind of pays for that engagement, losing the speed and also paying for it with his life. And now CAZ eSports sitting up closer to about 800 gold, so still not to that lead we were talking about before, but at least forcing an engagement over there on the solo side.
A lot of that gold gap being closed between Auzrik and Maloaise, partially because of that first blood bounty that Auzrik was able to secure, getting that first blood online so soon. But you're right, as soon as the XP starts to climb up a little bit more, it's just difficult for Auzrik to try and have the same sort of pressure contest as Maloaise, because Awilix is also another melee range god, except she's not as tanky as what an Erlang can be. And even though her ultimate is great when it comes to that shredding potential, it can be difficult to try and knock up the Erlang, especially since Maloaise has so many different ways that he can self-peel.
And this is a potential power play for CAZ eSports if they're able to get their back timers correct. Just about everyone on their side is over level 12, so they're able to get those second relic spots. We only just saw Predators roll over to that level 12, so that would mean like Auzrik would be without it, as well as 50-meter fly, DineOhSaw, so it could be a chance for them to force a fight knowing that they've got a few more relic slots. They do back and fill those out now, so they've got just a brief window where they can try and force something.
And DineOhSaw, he might be looking to force something in the dual lane right now. Atonement, though, gonna spot that one out. DineOhSaw thinking about getting that rollout online towards him, but with that Medusa having the dash and being able to get so far away, DineOhSaw kind of just recognizes he doesn't really have a chance to gank him.
One of the reasons Medusa is so safe, we did see DineOhSaw choose to go with just the sprint, so that would be kind of the only way to have relic-wise to try and initiate. Once that rollout came out, it's fairly obvious, then there was no problem for Atonement just to back up there and get back to safety. We got several members over here in this solo lane side jungle. Switch looking to try and help out, but it's Auzrik who pulls back in. Maloaise used the beads, though, so he doesn't end up all the way under tower. DineOhSaw taking tons of damage from the backside. Elexum in particular helping set up the kill. Switch ends up getting credit for that one. CAZ eSports now up 2-1 and looking to further invade onto this blue blue, Auzrik has no problem, though, jumping over the wall to get away.
And one more time, just like all the others, Kaz finally able to secure that blue buff yet again. Might be able to find Predators in the mix as well. T1 Tower and Solo sitting at about 50% health, so not the safest place to be right now, especially when three members from Kaz are staring you down.
And they're going down beyond the Tier 1 tower. Mr. Turtle in that rage form, getting the mess off on the Predators, trying to make life hard. He does have the 72 transformations, able to just run away, no problem. But that Tier 1 tower, it will not be the same story. It falls, and CAZ eSports able to come over and get those Oracles. So a win on both sides of the map. And I think, Taco, this is what we were looking to see.
This is definitely what we were waiting for out of CAZ eSports, kind of just kicking it up a notch. And for DineOhSaw, he didn't have his rollout when he initially stepped into the lane, but that wasn't even the problem. Elexum just connecting with that raw snipe made it all too impossible for him to try and stay alive. He'd already used his shield to try and help peel for his teammates, so that was just really well-executed target focus by Kaz.
Kaz comes in, they decide they want to take down DineOhSaw, and they do it very well. DineOhSaw ends up taking that trip back to base, and we were talking about how Elexum might potentially be suffering a little bit in the damage department compared to 50-meter fly, but that has just not been the case so far. In fact, he's almost caught up in terms of stacks here now. He's actually up two levels thanks to being able to be a part of two kills already as opposed to only one for 50-meter fly, and he's looking towards Spear of Desolation. That's been finished out.
There is a small difference, though, to be noted between the two hunters. Right now, we see Atonement actually opting for that more typical ability-based build for ADCs, going for the Warrior, Tabi, Transcendence, Brawlers now even, really just trying to delay a Vaporish from reaching the full benefits of having that Executioner Devourer's Gauntlets online. It's going to be really difficult for Vaporish to keep boxing around this Medusa, having to worry about that Brawlers.
That Brawler's Beatstick is going to reduce the benefit from the Devourer's Gauntlet. Atonement recognizing a little bit more ability-based is Medusa, so looking just to get more power out of it. But it's Auzrik who could be in trouble. Not just that, but Kaz are able to also start up the Gold Fury on the left side, and only Vapor's Coast is around. Cataclysm comes out for DineOhSaw, knocking up Mr. Turtle up into the air, and 50-meter fly, there he is with the follow-up. I'm a monster, sends Mr. Turtle back to base. Gold Fury does fall, but 50-meter fly happy to pick up that kill.
The speed buff has just respawned for Eanix. This might be one of the first ones that Auzrik is going to be seeing for a while now. Portal Demon actually being the next target for Eanix, recognizing that the Gold Fury has already been stripped off the map thanks to that sound off. I think that Eanix really want to try and see if they can get away with this one.
Audio cue comes through, and that lets them know Eanix are able to take down that Portal Demon and secure it, and the call seems to be from DineOhSaw to go in on Maloaise, and he does. The stun from Predators was actually perfectly timed, but too many members of CAZ eSports were there, and they have to back off, and they end up in that engagement. Ultra comes out from Atonement. Aegis, though, is perfectly timed for Vapor's Coast to avoid the damage, able to walk away despite the slow, but CAZ eSports, they want to try and get this tower, as even Elexum committing his ult.
Elexum wasn't done just yet. He saw that lazy back trying to come through. You're not safe underneath your T1 tower when there is a raw around. One time too many, we've seen it happen with the raw snipes just cleaning somebody up, and that seems to be the case for Kaz, taking away that Gold Fury, taking away the T1 tower, and now stripping the jungle of buffs for Eanix.
Predators is rotating in, trying to look and see if he can get anything from Atonement, but just a little bit too safe is that Medusa, so just having to back off. Now everything looking even as far as the kill department is concerned, 2-2, but Kaz are up about 2,800 gold or so. This is the lead we were saying, but 17 minutes in, is that kind of too late?
I don't think so. I do feel as though Eanix certainly have some comeback potential. Actually getting off a very successful invade right there. Auzrik giving Kaz a little taste of their own medicine.
There's that hand
and
of the gods.
Yeah. Mr. Turtle and Maloaise probably not too happy about that one, but Predators and Auzrik certainly glad that they managed to get away.
Good poke from 50-meter fly onto Mr. Turtle as well. So he's chilling at half his health, but of course he has a raw on his team, so he's never going to be too low, able to get some of that healing back up. And that's something that maybe a little bit noticed by Eanix. They do have the Brawler's Beatstick coming out from Auzrik, who will probably be the main one putting pressure onto Elexum, trying to get some anti-heal out. But because Raw is sort of one where they back up and heal usually out of combat, the anti-heal can't do too much to it.
Awilix does have that long-range strike, though, with her third ability. It's pretty useful. And so with that in mind, it'll still be possible for the Brawler's Beatstick proc to at least be added onto Elexum as long as Auzrik is on point with that ability.
And there's two blinks picked up from Eanix now, so they're looking to initiate aggressively. Both Auzrik and DineOhSaw have that blink so they can get into the back line. DineOhSaw looking for the blink cataclysm, and Auzrik looking to go into the back and use that moonlit charge to knock someone up and set up the rest of his damage. So that's something CAZ eSports are going to have to be aware of.
And again, CAZ taking what they can find, which is now the purple buff from Eanix. Four members grouped up in that duo lane. Wouldn't be too surprised to see them maybe try and siege the T1 tower, but seems as though CAZ has other plans, kind of just trying to play it safe right now, maybe looking to bait Eanix a little bit deeper into the jungle, not wanting to have to dive Eanix underneath their own tower line.
Eanix have kind of shown them that despite the early comp, they can hang with them and fight, and maybe CAZ aren't feeling too confident taking anything if they don't feel like they have a bit of an advantage. They are going to try and siege down this tier 1 tower. There's the blink from DineOhSaw. Cataclysm on the three members and the knockup as well. Taunt back in though. DineOhSaw getting rooted in place. 50 meter fly trying to help out with the I'm a monster over the top, and that let Auzrik rotate in and root in place. Elexum, Vaporous Coast gets that one cleaned up with the snipes up in the air. Predators though, he's up on the somersault cloud. Not even needed though. 50 meter fly cleaning up Maloaise.
And Vaporous Coast actually getting the double kill, finishing off Switch. What started out looking like a promising engagement for CAZ eSports was just turned entirely all off of that I'm a monster from 50 meter fly, connected onto three different members from CAZ.
They grouped up on the raw heal under the tower, I feel like was the problem there, Taco. They were trying to siege it. DineOhSaw recognized it immediately, blinks in cataclysms, three members, and the fallout from the rest of his team was excellent. CAZ eSports were on the back foot, it felt like almost the whole engagement. Now three kills up, 5-2, said Eanix, and that gold lead's been cut down to about 1,500. And they're making a fire giant call.
And it's only Mr. Turtle here around to try and defend. Not sure that he's going to really be able to stop this one from happening, though. Predators does have his hand in the gods available. Mr. Turtle, though, popping that thorns already. But Eanix, all too soon, destroying the fire giant. They don't even care about trying to clean up Mr. Turtle. They just want to go back to base.
Such a clean call at the end of that. They secure the objective, and before they give anything back, they get the heck out of Dodge. Now they're able to go back, regroup, get some items online, and come back out and start trying to make their own siege and trying to do what CAZ eSports just failed at on that long laid side tower.
They haven't taken any T1 towers yet, but I'm certain that that's probably about to change very quickly here for Eanix. T1 tower in the mid lane's already down to pretty much 20% health. There's some folk on both of the side lanes as well for those T1s.
Scylla's in the I'm a monster. 50 meter fly is ready to try and set someone up, and they pull back in. And I think it's Switch that they pull back in. Yeah, the I'm a monster hits a 50 meter fly, cleans it up with the crush. They recognize that the call was going to be for the Gold Fury, and they get a kill out of that one.
Well, that's a huge blow for CAZ, losing one of their supports. That's one of their frontliners, also one of their initiators. And now it's going to be the siege is on for Eanix, already taking the T1 tower in mid, looking to clean up that second one as well.
Now they're going for that tier 2 tower. CAZ eSports only have Maloaise and Mr. Turtle here to try and defend. That crush has been doing well all game. We talked about how Scylla, once she comes online, will be a terror in the game, sitting 3-0-3 with that Spirit Desolation already fixed, and she's been coming up big so far.
And the same could be said pretty soon here for over a Porish Coast as well. Predators actually going up into the cloud on that Sun Wukong, really trying to allow Eanix as much time as possible to take this T2 tower. And actually, Mr. Turtle just getting completely taken out by a Porish Coast.
Predators doing a good job locking him down underneath that Tier 1 tower with that Tiger Stun and setting up his AD carry, Vapor's Coast, to come in with all that damage he's been building. He's starting to go into a crit build now with that Poison Star, so he's going to be swinging a little bit harder. Elexum and the rest of his team are here to try and slow down this portal demon, but it goes down way too fast. Eanix get that objective as well.
Love this decision making by Eanix to go for the portal demon as opposed to just aggressing onto the T1 and T2 towers in the solo lane side. And I say this because now Eanix have a free back and comeback in card. If they get a little bit poked out while taking this T1 tower, it should still fall relatively fast enough for them to even look for one or two members to back to base safely and then just immediately come back through that portal.
And four members strong are Eanix over here on that solo side. Tier 1 tower not even worth defending. CAZ eSports instead backing up, and they're going to be looking to defend on this Tier 2 tower already into the I'm a monster, though. It's 50 meter fly, expecting the setup from DineOhSaw, who goes in, not able to knock anyone up. So 50 meter fly doesn't get anything out of that ultimate this time, but they clear enough space to where the Tier 2 tower has already fallen. Pluck comes out from Switch, though.
And Predators is going to be the one pulled back into the mix, but he's a Sun Wukong. He's just going to use his transformations to get right on out of there with the Ox Form, knocking up anybody in his path. Eanix, easy disengage. And with the Fire Giant still having a little bit more time around them, they're just going to be looking to try and get that ward dominance back on the Fire Giant side of the map and then maybe look for the push in the dual lane. But they'd be pretty safe just waiting things out for the next FG respawn.
And I like what we saw from 50 meter flying that last fight. Goes up into the I'm a Monster. DineOhSaw kind of just rolls forward, and CAZ eSports had to back up. They respect the damage from Scylla a little bit too much right now. Well, not too much, but they got to respect it. And it's enough for them to at least clear enough space to get that tier 2 tower without having to worry about any kind of casualties. As you said, they got a little bit left on that Fire Giant, but now they're thinking about getting prepared for that next respawn of it.
And Maloaise and the rest of CAZ kind of just doing what they can to look for a little bit of ward control. That's kind of all they can do. Their draft isn't by any means out of the late game. They still have plenty of damage they could try and bring online to take out the members from Eanix, but it seems as though Eanix is feeling pretty confident considering that Vaporish just pushed that T1 all by himself.
Just went up and knocked it down. He recognizes that he's got not just the Poison Star, but that Deathbringer online now, so plenty of power in the kit, and then that steroid giving him the attack speed he needs, and he's able to start shredding through these objectives. Lining up here around the Gold Fury, which still is a minute away from spawning, so Eanix probably not looking to have too much happen there as they head back towards the mid lane.
And Atonement actually opting for this Hide of the Urchin as opposed to another damage item, so he might be feeling that one. I can understand the desire for survivability, but his positioning has been pretty strong in most of these team fights. I'm curious to see how this is going to work out for him, because his team might feel that lack of damage coming through from their carry as opposed to Vaporish, who just committed straight to the damage build.
And he hasn't been able to have much of an impact. Look at that line. There's only been two kills for CAZ eSports, but he hasn't been a part of either one of them so far. His impact in these teamfights is going to be big. The way that we've seen 50 meter fly coming up big with that I'm a Monster, Atonement ult's kind of one of their big teamfight ultimates that they need to hit multiple members.
But this could be it for CAZ. The chance to turn it all around will be pretty difficult, though, trying to pack a punch through DineOhSaw. Now a level 16 Geb. He's got that shell online. He's got sprint online, actually. But with the shield being fully charged, it's going to be pretty difficult to try and drop anybody from Eanix quickly.
Predator's looping around the backside, but Maloaise was here along with Elexum. They recognize what he was up to, and they'll keep him from being able to come in through this way. But it's Eanix who are the ones getting a little bit more of the aggressive positioning around this portal demon, waiting for it to respawn, giving themselves a doorway back through to this Fire Giant pit, as Fire Giant will be the eventual big goal they're looking for here.
And it's pretty much all eyes on Auzrik here for me, because Auzrik is probably the most susceptible carry on Eanix right now. As a Awilix having to get into melee range if he wants to try and commit to someone, that puts him in a pretty difficult position, because if his team isn't around in a follow-up or DineOhSaw isn't there to help peel with him, that could be a very dead Awilix in no time at all.
And it feels like that's the conscious decision Eanix has made. CAZ eSports have gone a lot tankier, even in the jungle. Their Maloaise building tanky, but they want the damage coming out from just about everyone on their team, relying very much on DineOhSaw to be that frontline pressure presence for them, along with Predators. And they've been doing a great job of it this game, keeping those carries safe.
Really like the decision-making, though, for Auzrik to opt straight into that stone-cutting sword and the chin size, just cutting away at those protections, at the health. So a lot of the benefits that you would typically see from stacking up all these Hide of the Urchins kind of just being stripped away. It's going to come down to how Eanix team play this, though.
And DineOhSaw has been the one with his cataclysms that's been setting up these team fights for his team. We just saw the blink in from Auzrik to try and get a knockup, but wasn't able to get anything out of it, so that won't be available for 90 seconds from the jungler, but DineOhSaw still has his available.
And that's going to be a pretty tricky situation. Atonement actually opting to pull the portal demon. Seems as though that might be the first objective that these teams are looking for. Now DineOhSaw, though, he got the four-man cataclysm. He's looking to go in. Mr. Turtle already down to underneath half HP, 10%, but both him and Switch looking to get away.
Up into the air was Vapor's Coast trying to clean up the kill, but unable to. But that was the initiation we were talking about. DineOhSaw blinks in, four-man cataclysm, immediate follow-up from 50-meter fly, and now the pull back in from Auzrik puts Maloaise into a lot of trouble. Elexum trying to help peel with his ultimate does bring Auzrik very low, but the portal demon secured by Eanix.
And that was a great secure there by Eanix. Even though Atonement's starting to pull this Fire Giant, can't imagine CAZ trying to stick around for much longer. It's most likely going to be a tanky member from Eanix that tries to go through that portal first. And with DineOhSaw having vision on all of them, don't see how they're going to get away with it.
Predators comes through right away using that Master's Will into three members, and they were hoping maybe for some reason Vaporish or 50-meter Fly might walk through and they could take him right away. But as you said, Sun Wukong came through. They couldn't cut him down to size. And now, once again, Eanix, taking that small victory from that last fight, are going to be trying to come back in and this time force the Fire Giant and get a hard engage from Kaz.
Makes things a little bit easier as well when Geb was right there staring everybody down from Kaz, kind of just letting his team know their positioning. Auzrik taking away those oracles, but DineOhSaw and 50-meter Fly again just trying to get out what poke they can. 50-meter Fly doesn't have a Divine Ruin, so these crushers aren't proccing any anti-heal, but with the Brawler's Beatstick still online for Auzrik, it's just going to be all about focusing whoever gets procced by that.
This prolonged engagement could eventually start to go in Kaz's favor, as you said, with those heals from Raw, the Lotus Crown providing some additional protections to those who do receive the healing as well. But there's the blink in one more time from DineOhSaw. I don't believe he was able to get anyone with that Cataclysm, but Switch still gets blown up in the backline. DineOhSaw takes a lot of damage for that initiation, but he's able to roll on out. There's the ultimate from Atonement finally coming through, hitting two members, but it's not enough. Mr. Turtle very low. He has to back off, and Predators are going to keep pushing on the gas.
50-meter Fly barely, or saving that engagement actually, getting the connect with the I'm a Monster, getting the reset, and immediately going back in, almost killing Mr. Turtle in the process. But Mr. Turtle, one more time, just barely escapes with his life.
Luckily though, CAZ eSports bring Auzrik very low as well as DineOhSaw very low, so they didn't feel comfortable. Did Eanix starting up this objective despite the fact that Switch was sitting on that respawn timer. Now it'll likely be another 5v5 grouping as Eanix didn't win the fight by a large enough margin.
Also really liking this positioning from Vaporish Coast, because while everything's happening on the front side, no one's really noticing how Vaporish is kind of just free casting on the back line. He's just been tossing out those in-hands, connecting very consistently, and that's all that they really need from a ROM who's opted for the triple crit build.
He's almost done with that Wind Demon too. Once he is, he'll be even more of a force to be reckoned with in these team fights. We've seen him going up in the air. He's positioning really far back, kind of relying on his ultimate to clean up some kills in the end, but when he needs to, he'll step up, and now he has making the call to start pulling on this Fire Giant. Mr. Turtle is the one furthest forward. Switch now rotating back in, Atonement in the further back, but DineOhSaw goes in onto Mr. Turtle, but he's tanky enough to start jumping in onto 50-meter Fly. Elexum's ultimate, which is a little bit too late, doesn't connect with 50-meter Fly.
Even if it had, 50-meter Fly had that Geb Shield and also used the Aegis just to be extra safe. And now it's going to be the return around. DineOhSaw going straight onto Switch. Cataclysm popped off, and I'm a Monster cleaning him out with Vaporish.
Now Mr. Turtle's the only one to be the front line for the rest of the team. Maloaise is there with him as well in that turtle form trying to knock him up. But Auzrik blinks in, and he's going in onto Atonement, who's very low on the backside, has to run away. Mr. Turtle falls as well to Vaporish Coast. That's two quick kills for Eanix. Now they're up 5v3. Maloaise sticking around a little bit too long. Sorry, buddy, you're going back to base as well as Vaporish Coast gets the double kill.
Even with the heal from his ultimate, it wouldn't have made the difference. Just way too much protection shred online for Auzrik. Having that Heartseeker available as well is just making things almost impossible. Alexum's ultimate should be back up right around now, though. He's looking to just try and go in, already using the beads, the Aegis, everything. And Vaporish again, one more time, goodbye.
Elexum just comes up a little bit too far in that engagement. The whole of Eanix halted all DPS onto the Fire Giant and just converged in on him. He commits both relics to try and stay alive, but they're not enough. Now Eanix sitting up 12-2 are the kills, sitting up about 6,000 gold, and with that Fire Giant around their waist and two Phoenixes exposed, they've got a Gold Fury on their minds and a Tier 2 tower to clean up after that.
That is worst case scenario for Kaz, and I say that because Elexum, even if he had the possibility to look for the steal there, he was still expending both of his actives. So now when Eanix look for the Phoenix shove, which I'd imagine they're going to try and siege immediately that final remaining T2 tower in the dual lane, then push onto that left-hand Phoenix as well, since it's the furthest away. And on top of that, it'll be really difficult for Elexum to not just get immediately focused upon.
In particular, Auzrik will have his blink available for this next engagement. And as you said, Elexum won't have those relics. So Auzrik, and I'm sure at this level that they're aware of those cooldowns, he knows that his target's going to be that Raw in this next engagement. So it'll be the positioning from Elexum will need to be spectacular to survive this next sort of 80 seconds worth of cooldowns he has to sit on.
And I've just got to say it. I think that there is a serious lack of damage from CAZ eSports draft right now. Elexum doing decent damage whenever he's connecting with his raw snipes, but I am not feeling the same sort of impact as what we are witnessing from Vaporish and 50 meter fly off of their combinations. It just seems as though Eanix is way more in sync with themselves, and considering that they don't have as much defense stacked up on their carries just went for the damage.
And Taco, for me, this all comes down to that push that we saw CAZ making on that Tier 1 tower in the duo lane. DineOhSaw's engage on that was perfect to shut down their aggression. That was when Eanix sort of finally got control of the game, and they haven't given it back up since then. Now it's Predators going in. Actually, the plug comes out from Switch to pull DineOhSaw down into trouble. He's taking a lot of damage, but Predators and him are too tanky. They're actually okay. Taunt does come out, though, from Maloaise to try and pull him back in, but he gets the heal back off, so now he's all right as well. No one falls. And the heels are going to benefit CAZ in this.
Mr. Turtle trying to do what his name suggests, but it's going to be actually Switch one more time. Taken out, but a beautiful ultimate from Elexum connecting with two. Rival able to find the kill on the Predators with Vaporish being dead, but 50 meter fly returning the favor onto Elexum with that crush.
The crush coming through from 50 meter fly was huge at the end of that engagement, sending Elexum back to base. Now it's Auzrik who's the one in trouble. The Blink comes out though, and he's going to be able to use that speed buff and the leap from Suku to run away. Mr. Turtle's here to try and help out a little bit with the rest of his team, but DineOhSaw not afraid to run away. Wow, that searing pain came through huge, and I thought CAZ were going to win it big, Taco, but 50 meter fly with a double kill cuts him down to size.
CAZ actually did win it huge, though, because Elexum wasn't able, or actually Eanix wasn't able to siege that tower, but Maloaise, you're way too greedy. What are you doing?
Maloaise way up there without a hope, without a friend, without a care. 50 meter fly with the setup from his team gets one more kill added to his column, now sitting 7-0-5. He's having a great game. And look at this. DineOhSaw's able to come over here and contest this portal.
Sometimes you just want to go in for the kill. Great contest, though, by Eanix. Unfortunately, it's not going to be enough. That excellent last little pull by Mr. Turtle to get it away from 50-meter fly over the wall, that was a smart play.
Yeah, I think that 50-meter fly would have taken it if not for them pulling it just a little bit out of range. But you're right. Maloaise, buddy, I don't know about that one. Getting caught out in the jungle way too far. No friends around. I don't know what he was doing. He's in the wrong area.
He was hoping that it was just Auzrik, and then he realized he was in the wrong neighborhood.
Oh, yeah. He was definitely... Sometimes you walk down two blocks too far, and you realize you might be in a bad part of town. That's what happened there with Maloaise. He stepped into a bad area. Now Eanix able to regroup around this fire giant, which will be respawning in just about a minute, and do this dance one more time.
But still, that little victory, or actually the big victory, still would have to be credited to CAZ for the successful Phoenix defense. Mr. Turtle doing what his name suggests and just trying to turtle underneath that Phoenix. That's the best look right now for CAZ. I mean, it's just so much easier for them to try and play the safe route.
Once again, though, you just talked about Mr. Turtle, and he's the one getting blown up, taken down by Vaporous Coast. That flees up Mr. 50 meter fly to put that ultimate somewhere else, but doesn't find it. Cataclysm comes out from DineOhSaw. Maloaise getting shredded by the crits from Vaporous Coast. He goes up into the air and cleans that kill up. Ulta comes out from Atonement to slow down some of the aggression, but already two members down in favor of Eanix.
That's not the pluck that Switch wanted to find, though. Instead, he's going to have to be forced into that lurking in the water, trying to clean up Vaporous, and he will find it, but it might cost him his life. No, he's actually going to be able to get away. No, he's not actually Predators. Still finding the kill and the Geb Shield to save his own life.
Predators trusting DineOhSaw with his life there, and it comes up big. The shield from DineOhSaw very clutch to keep Predators alive despite how aggressive he played. But in particular, Taco, Vaporous Coast is swinging here in the late game, blowing up Mr. Turtle and Maloaise, not looking like tanks to me when they're going up against that late game Raw.
Atonement and Elexum, though, really doing their best to try and keep this one close. As soon as Mr. Turtle gets picked, you think that that's going to swing entirely in Enix's favor, but instead, Atonement right around the corner with that Petrify ultimate, and that just completely stopped Eanix in their tracks from the chase.
And if CAZ eSports had to pick one person to kill, I'm sure they would have liked to kill more, but Vaporous Coast likely would have been the one to halt some of their DPS onto the objectives. Atonement swinging not too bad himself here when Predators goes a little bit too aggressive. Shield coming out from DineOhSaw one more time to keep him standing, and without Vaporous Coast, they can't take down this fire giant.
Atonement's got that chin size and the Titan's Bane online now, making it a little bit easier to shred through Predator's health bar. And Predators actually try to stack a lot of it, and actually two members of Eanix with those urchins finished off completely.
Those urchins coming up big, both at 10 stacked for him. You're right, getting a whole lot of extra protections are both Predators and DineOhSaw here so far. But Taco, I want to talk about DineOhSaw. I feel like he's been playing this Geb at a really high level this game.
For DineOhSaw, it's really only been one ult that we've seen be off the mark, and that was just looked more like an overshot on the blink than anything else. Sometimes it happens, you can't stop it, push a little bit too far on that analog stick for the box boys, but I would have to agree with you. I think more importantly, it's been his map awareness for his teammates. Whoever is in danger is the one always immediately being given the shield, and these Geb shields have saved so many engagements for Eanix.
And I think what DineOhSaw is exposing is the thing you've been talking about all game, that CAZ eSports don't have a whole lot of damage. They kind of need to burst someone down with the searing pain coming out from Elexum in a best case scenario like we saw on that Phoenix defense. When DineOhsaw is on point with those shields, that's a way harder task for CAZ eSports to handle.
Yeah, Eanix really making this a difficult one for CAZ. Vaporish actually going to be the one starting up that Fire Giant switch, though, certainly alerting the rest of his team. But Eanix, they don't really want this FG. They want to force CAZ to fight them.
What's happened so far is they haven't been able to win these team fights by a large enough margin since that fight on the dual lane side tower that was like 20 minutes ago at this point. Eanix need to be able to win these fights more than just one. DineOhSaw goes in, blinks on the switch, knocks him up, but not really any immediate follow-up from the rest of the team. There comes the pull back in into the damage from 50-meter fly. The Ama Monster doesn't quite delete him, but switch is now very low. But did you see how deep Predators was in the back line? He's fighting down there all alone, trying to get... He's up against three!
Maloaise and Mr. Turtle, the only ones zoning out the rest of Eanix, and Predators actually baiting out the ultimate from Elexum, just shy of them hitting him. But either way, Eanix just got so spread in that engagement, unable to find the kill secure onto switch.
That wasn't the clean target selection that we've seen from him. They do make the call onto switch, but he's just too tanky at this point for them to blow up in one rotation. DineOhSaw gets plucked back in to the rest of CAZ eSports, has to shield himself. It knocks up Maloaise, though, to create a little bit of space for him. And in the back line, it's Mr. Turtle trying to go for Vaporous Coast, gets blown up by 50-meter fly, who hits him with the root. CAZ eSports think they have enough space to start up this portal demon, but Predator says otherwise.
It wasn't entirely for free for 50-meter fly, taking a pretty chunk of his own health because of the thorns that Mr. Turtle had dropped right before his death. But now that it's a 4v5, purely in favor for Eanix, and one more time, CAZ are going to have to try and hold off Eanix from sieging the Fire Giant or even winning the team fight.
And this is what's going to be very important for Eanix. They got to come down here and win this fight while they have the 5v4 man advantage. We can see Auzrik and DineOhSaw returning back in. Everyone's healthy. Everyone's good to go for this engagement. The four members of CAZ eSports, Switch in particular, are going to need to come up big and set up Elexum in this team fight.
And it's already Atonement. Actually, it was Predators looking like he's getting pulled. Maloaise in a lot of trouble. Auzrik just barely getting away because of that Geb shield, but that was a big petrify to come out of Atonement, and now without that team fighting ultimate, things are going to be a little bit more difficult for CAZ.
Atonement had to use it to keep his teammate alive. Now the portal demon under even less duress than before. All right down to half health. Scylla even backing in the back 50-meter fly, expecting them to secure this portal demon so she can come right back into the fight, but it looks like they drop it, so she might have to walk.
It doesn't seem as though Eanix are willing to risk it all yet. Now that Mr. Turtle has respawned, though, that's a huge plus for CAZ, knowing that they're going to have another frontliner to add back into their arsenal. And again, CAZ looking for this DineOhSaw, expending his blink, but not being able to find anybody for it.
That's too bad. The blink engage from DineOhSaw has been a huge part of what's gone well for Eanix in this game so far. And Taco, we're 42 minutes into this game. Whichever team wins one of these next team fights has a really good chance. And here comes the rollout, though, from DineOhSaw. He's rolling into the back line. There's the initiation. Cataclysm on the three members. I'm a monster. Lands on the two. Maloaise and Switch both very low. Predators up into the air on that somersault cloud. And he comes crashing down on the Maloaise to provide some additional damage. In the back, though, they're going to continue to take down that portal demon.
And that heal is going to be able to save them, but it won't be able to save Elexum as he gets completely destroyed by that crush combination from 50-meter fly.
50-meter fly, 9 on an 8, way up at the top of the player damage chart with 34,000 damage that he's done this game. Coming up huge on the late game, Scylla just gone unchecked this game. Now the Fire Giant, no one around from CAZ eSports to try and defend without Elexum to help out. Now Eanix can start grouping up and go for all three Phoenixes, which are exposed on the map. That last defense went really well for CAZ eSports, but now they're down a member. DineOhSaw once again rolling in.
They're down their most important member as well, because Elexum was one of the only reasons keeping these fights alive. DineOhSaw caught up in that petrify, but he's just too tanky. Nobody can do enough damage to kill him. The same can't be said for Maloaise, immediately taken out by Vaporish.
They put too much focus into DineOhSaw. Maloaise left alone in the backline, gets deleted. Now it's Switch who ends up going back to base. Elexum still sitting on his timer. Maloaise still sitting on 60 seconds as well. 5v2 now. Only Mr. Turtle and Atonement left alive to try and slow down the pressure from Eanix. I'm a Monster comes out. Crush comes out, bringing the Titan very low. Predators crashes back down on an Eanix. Looking like the team we saw in last week coming out and beating CAZ eSports.
50 meter fly. They didn't even care about killing people before they could get in their fountain. He just wanted to end that game and take that win. I can't blame him either. That was a really well-earned victory by Eanix. Excellent team play all around.
Yeah, they were about 43 minutes into that game, so I don't blame 50 Meter Fly for one to go ahead and just get that one over. They played very patiently, though. They did a good job with DineOhSaw in particular, waiting for his moments where they were grouped up, going to get the Cataclysm, 2, 3, 4 members, and setting up the rest of his team.
Patience is key sometimes, and for Eanix, it was really what made all the difference as the game kept going on. And the same could be said for CAZ. I mean, they were a little bit too patient. They started turning things up for a little bit. They were kicking it up a notch, but they didn't keep that pressure going. And then in the moment that they tried to, we called it when we saw it, that T1 tower engagement really was just the complete turning point of that game.
It was the turning point for him. Let's see if